guest today is a great singer, songwriter, and keyboard player for the band Bent Knee, who have a brand new album called Land Animal coming out on June 23rd. I'm pleased to welcome Courtney Swain. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, too.
So how are things?
Very well.
Cool. So you're on your headlining tour, right?
Yeah, we're starting our headlining tour next week.
Okay, and you just finished with Thank You Scientist. How was that?
It was great. They're awesome. It was a lot of fun.
No, I know those guys. They're nuts. I've been with them at shows, and they're crazy. So how was getting along with them? I mean, do you get into the shenanigans with them and all that?
Oh yeah. I mean, we're pretty goofy too. So it was a great fit. But we're sort of a tame band, you know. Like, we just, when we're done with shows, we go to bed. Like, we don't collectively drink or like do that many drugs, and so, you know, it's just like hilarious. Our stories, you know, like our best tour stories are like you know, a low medium on their scale of, you know, crazy stories. So it's just a lot of fun going around with them. And yeah, they do a lot of all ages shows. And they tend to sort of do, you know, reasonable, we play at reasonable times that are like not midnight and stuff. And
that's cool.
The touring itself, the conditions are really nice. And yeah, it was a lot of fun.
That's cool. So, all right. So you're probably getting tired of answering this question, but, you know, quick synopsis, you know, what's your background? How'd you get into playing and getting the band together?
We all came from different places and we all kind of met at Berklee College of Music. And the guitar player, Ben, and I started writing music together, and then eventually we sort of ended up with the six of us who were all, you know, like friends, basically. And there were a couple other people that were originally members, but, you know, it didn't work out. And so we've been the same lineup for about since the beginning of 2011. That was also the first year we did our first tour, and our first album came out. And basically for the first 4 or 5 years around then, we just did a lot of work independently. We produced 2 albums ourselves. And then we probably played between like 250 and 300 shows just booked independently. And we were getting to a point where we're just like bashing our head against the ceiling, just feeling like, what are we doing? You know, why isn't this working? And that was right around the time that we got in touch with Cuneiform Records, and they signed us. So we put out our last album, Say So, last May, and we did a bunch more touring. We went to Europe, and then we got to work with the Dillinger Escape Plan. And that sort of exposure led to signing with our current booking agent, and also with our new label, Inside Out. So that's where we are right now.
It seems like a long time, but really in the life of a band, that's sort of fast. I mean, from just forming to all the growth you guys have had, it's pretty amazing.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's really cool because up until maybe a year, maybe less than a year ago, we were doing everything independently, which meant that we were going from city to city and playing with, you know, local bands, which are a lot of times like less traveled, or, you know, in the worst case scenario, would be someone's like hobby band or something. And so we didn't really have a frame of reference of what everyone was really doing in terms of bands who tour and are doing it really seriously. And so, you know, since last year, we've been able to sort of meet more people like that who have poured, you know, more heart and soul and just time into their projects than we have. You know, obviously, which is the majority of bands most people know. You know, it's been really eye-opening, and it's been pretty cool. And I think, you know, when I started doing the band thing and started touring, I was sort of thinking, like, you know, I'll just try this for, like, 10 years and, you know, see how I feel in 10 years. And I really think that's kind of, like, a good place to sort of start and put your first benchmark. And I think we're doing pretty well.
I mean, you have definitely a weird style. It's different. It's totally original and kind of out there. Was there when you started writing, was it always, was it like that from the beginning when you started writing? Where did that influence come to not want to, be a pop artist or something and write just whatever, this kind of crazy stuff that comes to you?
Well, that's an interesting question. I think the first album and the other albums sort of ended up that way because of different reasons. The first album, we were really aiming to sound like Bjork or Portishead, because that was just kind of our influence at that time. And I think that's why it became kind of a odd left field electronic slash rock album. But after that, what happened was basically we write collaboratively with the six of us. So everyone has a lot of input into the end product, which becomes the Bent Knee song. And we, all six of us, don't really have a single artist that we agree on. There's a couple that everyone, likes, but there's no like, this is our artist that we want to sound like, or anything like that. And so I think everyone's bringing in such a diverse set of influences and musical gravitations that, when you put it all together and divide it into, sum it into this thing, it just ends up being very different.
Yeah, I could see that. So how does a song get started? Take, for example, the first single, Land Animal, which is really cool, really different. Talk about what that song is about and how does that get created from start to finish?
Sure. So, the way we write, someone brings in a demo in the beginning at sort of various degrees of doneness. It could be just a verse and chorus or just like a whole fleshed out song. And in the case of Land Animal, Ben brought in this demo. Land Animal was the first song that we wrote on the album, on this upcoming album. And he had most of the ideas kind of together. But what we do is we take it into rehearsal and we basically tear apart the different components and sort of put it back together, making space for everyone. We're a pretty big band, so a big concern when we play is to make sure that no one's stepping on anyone else's toes sonically. So everyone has their own space to play their part, and there's sort of like a foreground, middle ground, background texture that works. And I think this becomes really clear when we play in sort of less than good sound situations, because we can play pretty much anywhere from like a place with like four channels on the mixer where we're doing our own sound to a full production, and we sound pretty consistent. And I think it's because on the arranging level, we've kind of made room for everything, so you don't have to have someone constantly writing the faders in order to make it sound right. So, we'll do that part. With Land Animal, there's a very kind of Dilla inspired beat, that it was supposed to switch. There's like the I'm always at it every night, stuck in the fire, yearning for flight, and then it sort of switches, and it's halfway between kind of like a straight and a shuffle feel. And this whole album was a lot about experimenting with groove and sort of time more than our last album, which was more about experimenting with song form. So, Ben has these really cool ideas and he'll bring them in and we'll sort of like bastardize them a little bit because it was, between, again, everyone's influences or what they actually want to do, all the everything that comes in sort of gets diluted and sort of spread around. So that's how that happened.
That's cool. How many songs do you write that don't make it onto an album? When do you figure out, okay, these are the 10 songs, this is what we like?
So far, everything makes it onto an album, actually. We our writing process is very intense, and so that this album we wrote last summer, and it was the first time where we had like a writing week where we staked out a week and we'd show up at noon and go home at 7 and just like, we're gonna write for 7 hours. You know, before it was like,
that's cool,
let's meet on Tuesday nights rehearsal after everyone worked, you know, and like work for 3-4 hours. It was very sort of fragmented, but because we worked so focused, we were able to sort of determine how long it takes for us to figure out a song. And so basically it takes us about 9 to 12 hours to like be able to play a song, most of which is a lot of like, you know, depending on who you ask, discussion or arguing.
Right.
And so, you know, by the time we're done with the song, it's just so emotionally ingrained in us, and it takes us so much to write a song that we rarely cut stuff. Like a couple demos that we haven't touched that were written for the band. But also the other thing is everyone has side projects for the most part. So, you know, people, whatever that doesn't go into the band sort of gets funneled into our own side projects for various reasons.
You guys have sort of a indie or kind of alternative audience also, you know, a lot of your coverage is on those types of websites and magazines, but now you're sort of also getting this prog audience, which is typically older maybe. You know, what do you see when you look out into a crowd, and how do you approach being careful to get lumped into a label, you know, and keeping your own sort of thing? Or do you even worry about that?
Yeah, something we think about for sure. Last year was the big prog year for us. I would argue that we have been sort of, you know, our U.S. audience for a long time was college students, and then we had this huge year last year with so much love from the prog scene, and now we're sort of like halfway in between.
Right.
And I mean, I think it's one of the really awesome things about the band is that, you know, we can tailor what we're doing to play to pretty much anyone. You know, I was talking in a different interview about how we just did a acoustic show at a museum with, you know, like a 9-foot Steinway, and everyone's like wearing like suits and dresses to show up to this like event. And then meanwhile, you know, like we're just down to go down and like go back down into a basement and like, you know, play a really sweaty show where we're like shouting. And yeah, I think that dichotomy is a really big strength for us.
It's good. I mean, it opens up a lot of avenues that I think, you know, it's always good. And the prog audience, one thing about that you'll see is super loyal.
Oh, so. Absolutely. So we played a couple prog fests last year. And I just love it because every time we go to that area, you know, we played Rossfest and Prog Day. And so whenever we're in sort of New York, Maryland, or Pennsylvania, New Jersey, we'll just always see people wearing Rossfest shirts, which I think is just so sweet. And same with Prog Day, you know, we went down to Durham. We were in Durham like 2 weeks ago, and the guy who runs Prog Day was there, and there were a bunch of people who had seen us there. And I you know, it's really humbling to see that and to, you know, to get to recognize people and, you know, the support. And yeah, it's nice.
So being a younger band that got its start in the whole digital download streaming time, you know, how do you look at the fact that, you know, you might not ever sell a million albums, right? That's like something no one does anymore. What do you look at in terms of what success now with the whole industry so different?
That's an interesting question. I mean, I think for us, success right now is just to be able to make a living off of our music. And, you know, that can really come in any form. In the long term, you know, it would be nice if we don't have to rely on touring as much as we become older. But fortunately, it's something that most of us really enjoy doing. So it's not really like a hindrance.
Well, that's where a lot of older bands actually make their money is the touring, right? So that's why
Oh yeah,
that's
I mean
what they keep
us
doing,
too,
yeah.
you know. But I think there's, I think the thing about, you know, being younger, I suppose, like I get really like mad when people say like, "Oh, I'm so old." Like it really bugs me because I feel like they're like training me to say it when I'm old, like a little older, and I hate that. I think that the thing is that, you know, we have been in this sort of changing field for the whole time we've been a band.
Yeah.
So it's not really surprising. And, you know, there's a lot of opportunities that sort of come up. You know, some of them are short-lived, some of them are long-lived, depending on what the newest innovation or what the newest business model is. And so I think our band has largely been about, you know, like very good at adapting to whatever new technology or new platform that is available. And yeah, I mean, you know, people talk about streaming and how it's killing the industry and whatnot, but I just think that there's also maybe another way to think about it is that it's just a young platform and there's a lot to come of it.
Yeah.
And I think like in Boston, we a couple pretty significant venues closed recently and people were talking about how terrible that is, but I really think it's just part of urban development. And, you know, when something closes, it's just another opportunity for something else to open. So, you know, the way streaming is, if it's not feasible, it won't last. And, you know, I think just sort of
Yeah, it makes
things,
sense.
yeah, come of it, you know, as it sort of happens. And you just have to be adaptable and sort of have the perseverance to sort of work through that.
Right. What are you listening to when you're not playing in with the band?
What am I listening to? I can tell you. I'll just look on my phone. So I was just listening to Meta by Carbomb. They're super cool, like kind of tech metal. They were just opening for Gojira.
Okay.
And I was also listening to Moonshaped Pool, Radiohead. I'm really into Run the Jewels right now, which is sort of like a hip hop group.
Yeah.
I was listening to Fever Daydream by the Black Queen, which is a side project of the singer from Dillinger Escape Plan. Massive Attack, Laura Marling, Adult Jazz, Slow Dive.
You are all over the place.
Oh,
That's very
yeah.
cool. So I see what you mean.
Yeah, it's just like, you know, I'm listening to tech metal. I'm listening to like EDM. I'm listening to like folk, I'm listening to hip hop, you know, it's just, I
Yeah,
just
hey.
like, I don't really draw the line.
That is very cool. Well,
Yeah.
awesome. Nice to finally meet you and
Yeah,
talk in
likewise.
person, and super happy for the success of the band. And I think, God, it feels like you've now had the album forever, and we've all been listening to the album forever. It's not even out yet.
I know,
So,
I can't wait for it to hit.
yeah, that's going to be very cool when everybody gets a chance to hear it and see you guys on the road. So,
Thank you so much. I'm really excited we got to talk. This is really
yeah.
fun.
Very cool. Thank you. Have a good one.
Okay. All right. Take care.
Bye.
Bye.
Thanks to Courtney for the interview. We're going to close with the title track from Land Animal. You can catch their new album on June 23rd and on tour through the month of June. For upcoming news and interviews, please check theprogreport.com, follow us on Facebook at The Prog Report on Twitter, or download the podcast on iTunes. Thanks.
huddle. I'll drag my body through tiniest tunnels. It turns me on to soon be gone. I'm a sender. Scraps on the table.